Welcome to Prescott 83 Sunday Morning Worship Service with Pastor Vince Deaglin.
We're in Mark chapter 3. We've been working through the Gospel of Mark. I think it's important to emphasize over and over again why we're doing it. The whole idea of our study is we're trying to spend time with Jesus, spend the day with Jesus, walk through his daily activities with this idea in mind. The more we do that, the more we spend time with Jesus, the more we see him in action, we're giving the Holy Spirit an opportunity. And the Holy Spirit will work on us to make us a whole lot more like Jesus. And so that's the plan. We began, as I said, several weeks back, and Mark presents Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah, God come in human form to be our Savior, and he's writing with a certain degree of bias. He is all in. He believes in Jesus. He sees him as the Messiah, and he wants his readers to believe in Jesus in the same way he does, and that's why I think he writes in the style that he does. It's a very straightforward, no-nonsense style. It focuses on all of these miraculous things that Jesus is doing because he's trying to convince us Jesus really is the Son of God. And we've already seen time and again through the different things Jesus has done that there wasn't anyone like him ever before nor since. No one can compare to him. Now, as we come to chapter 3, Mark continues that style, but there's a little twist here, and I think this is the main focal point for chapter 3. It's at least the one I'm going to emphasize, because woven throughout the chapter, we're going to see little bits and pieces of evidence that Mark once again presents that prove that Jesus is the Messiah. But woven throughout the chapter, here's what we're going to find. Different groups of people looking at the exact same stuff, but coming to completely different conclusions. And I think it's a very, very important text. It was important in Jesus' day. I think it's just as important in our day for this simple reason. There's no middle ground when it comes to Jesus. You're either a believer or you're a non-believer. And there's no Switzerland. There's no I'm going to just be neutral and no harm, no foul, and everything will be fine. No. You're either a believer or you're not. Everyone has to make up their mind about Jesus. So let's start our study. We're going to look at the first 12 verses where, once again, I believe Mark presents evidence that demonstrates, well, Jesus is exactly who he claims to be. Starting in verse 1, another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. And Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." And Jesus asked them, meaning those that were, they're kind of looking for an opportunity to accuse Jesus. Jesus asked them, "What's lawful on the Sabbath? To do good or to do evil? To save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. And he looked around at them in anger, and he was deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. And he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." And he stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began the plot with the Herodians, how they might kill Jesus. And Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard about all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward just to touch him. And whenever the impure spirit saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell others about him. What we have here in chapter 3 is very similar to what Mark has presented in the first two chapters. He's going to focus on miraculous healings, and he's going to focus on demonic exorcisms with the purpose that, in his mind, this is evidence that demonstrates who Jesus is, that he is, in fact, the Son of God. Now, I think the logical connection between chapter 2 and chapter 3 is the Sabbath controversy that we just read about. When you look at Jesus' ministry, if you read the Gospels, what you'll find is Jesus tended to be a lightning rod. He did not conform to the traditions of Judaism as they had evolved, which is very different than Jesus didn't obey the law. You understand that? The law would say one thing. The traditions of Judaism interpreted what the law said in this way. And Jesus did not recognize all of their traditions. And as a result, it was a lightning rod of accusation and claims that Jesus couldn't be a godly man because he disobeyed the law. But yet, the traditions didn't always do a good job of representing the law. We looked at this last week to some extent. Jesus understands the true purpose of the Sabbath. He knew what God intended. In fact, if we go back to what did the law actually say? Remember the Sabbath, keep it holy. Now, what does holy mean? It could be understood in many different ways. It would always include the idea of keep it sacred. Make sure that this is a day that is dedicated to God, a day of purity, a day of wholesomeness and goodness and all of those things that we would associate with God. And the setting before us is such that we have a synagogue meeting. We're united here to worship our God. And Jesus notices an individual who has some kind of disability. And he also recognizes that the religious leaders there who have already demonstrated hostility towards him, they are way more dedicated to their traditions. Let's call it the status quo. They're way more dedicated to the status quo because they benefited from the status quo. They're seeing Jesus as a threat. They're looking for some ground that they can accuse him as a sinner so that he will be discredited and he will lose his popularity. But Jesus understands the true purpose of the Sabbath. And we see that in the question he asks. He has the fellow with the disability stand up. And then he looks at the crowd that's kind of doing one of these. You know, they're just looking at him as like, okay, we're going to wait for him to do something wrong and then we're going to pounce. And he asks them, is it okay to do good on the Sabbath or evil? Is it okay to save a life on the Sabbath or to take a life? What is the mind and the heart of God when it comes to what we can and cannot do on the Sabbath? And if you notice in the text, they didn't answer him because they knew they were stuck. Because you can't answer the question by saying, oh, no, you can only do evil on the Sabbath and you can only kill on the Sabbath. You can't answer that way. But they also can't say, well, it's okay to do good and it's okay to save a life. Because they know what Jesus will do if they do that. So they just keep their mouth shut. And Jesus is rightly upset with their hardness of heart. But he isn't about to let their hostility to influence him to deviate from the mission. He knows what he's about to do is controversial. He knows he's going to be falsely accused, but he's going to use this as an opportunity to do two things. Once again, he's going to demonstrate who he is. I am the Son of God. I'm going to demonstrate that by doing this miracle. Two, I'm going to liberate this man who's been suffering for we don't know how long with this disability. I'm going to liberate him from his disability. And so Jesus heals him. And then Mark kind of concludes this particular section of chapter 3 by giving us a general overview of the kind of thing that was happening at around this time with Jesus in the region of Galilee. Crowds were following everywhere he went. They're coming from all over, from the southern parts of Israel to the northern, not suburbs, but the region surrounding northern Israel. They're coming from everywhere because Jesus' fame is spreading. And they're coming with an expectation that Jesus is going to heal. And he did not disappoint. And then Mark rounds out the chapter by referring to demonic exorcisms. And we talked about this a little bit. I don't know if it was last week or the week before. It's not something that we have a great deal of information on. And as a result, our ability to understand all that is involved with demonic possession is very, very limited. But there are some absolutes that we do know from Scripture. Number one, we absolutely know Satan is real. The Bible doesn't present Satan as some mythical figure that doesn't actually exist. No, he's very real. Demons are the angels that followed Satan when Satan rebelled. And the Bible teaches us that as many as one-third of all the angels God created followed Satan in his rebellion. And it's those fallen angels that are these demonic spirits that the Bible refers to. Now, this is a little bit more speculation, but the Bible presents God as a person who respects our free will. He doesn't violate our free will. He gave us free will. He respects it. I don't know that I would say Satan respects our free will, but I don't think he has a choice. I don't think he can override our free will. If you're really old like me, you can probably remember Flip Wilson saying, "The devil made me do it." No, the devil doesn't make us do anything. We may choose to do something, but I don't think Satan can just override our free will, because if he could, why wouldn't he? I mean, he could just, like we were talking about with the child dedication, he could just push all the right buttons and just override my free will and have me doing all kinds of satanic stuff. And so I think he is very, very limited in what he can do, meaning I believe he needs some kind of opening, some degree of permission before he can be influential in my life. And I think that permission or that invitation or that opening can even occur at a subconscious level. And I say that because there's a lot of scripture that talks about how sin works. One of the passages says a little leaven, a little yeast leavens the entire lump of dough, and it's in reference to sin. In other words, as soon as Satan gets a foothold in my life, what do I know to be true? He's not going to be satisfied with a foothold. He's going to want more and more and more and more and more. But he needs that permission. He needs that opening. He needs to gain that foothold. And once he gets it, he'll be relentless and he will never be satisfied. But I think Mark's point in sharing this is to point out, as great, as powerful, as influential as Satan is in these different individuals that Mark presents to us, Jesus is greater. Jesus is more powerful. Satan and all of his demonic allies have no ability to stand against Jesus, so that whenever Jesus encounters demonic possession, he sets that person free by casting out the demon. And I've often had people say, well, why did Jesus command the demons to be silent and not tell anybody who he was? Think about it. Would you want demons advertising you? Hey, that Jesus guy, he's the Son of God. He's a great guy. And it's coming from a demon. It'd be the equivalent of, if we can try to come up with a modern, you know, kind of illustration, is if you got someone who's down on their luck and you know they've really been beaten up by life in general, and saying, hey, go to Andy. Andy's a great financial advisor. And they're looking at you, it's like, why did Andy give you your advice? And I don't want to end up like you, type thing. You see what I'm saying? So Jesus doesn't want the demons to be advertising for him. He'd rather have his own actions speak for themselves, so he would tell the demons to be silent. Why is Mark doing all of this? Why is Jesus doing all of this? Kind of goes back to where we started. Mark is trying to be persuasive. He's trying to influence his readers to believe as he does. And I believe there's a really good account here in Matthew that I want to share with you. Starting in verse 2, when John was in prison and he heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? Now, let me just stop right there. John's in prison. He's in prison for speaking out against the government. And in that culture, that never went well for you. So he's in prison. Now, if you put yourself in John's position, I'm pretty sure John's thinking, well, this isn't how that's supposed to happen. This isn't how things are supposed to work out. Hey, I was the forerunner preparing the way for Messiah, and now I'm in prison. And I think as things played out the way they did, I think it's pretty obvious to say John has some doubts. He's asking Jesus, are you the one, or should I be expecting someone else? Here's what I think is really cool about John and his doubts, because I think doubts are very normal. If you've ever had doubts, let me say to you as clearly as I can, you're normal. If you never had any doubts, I suspect you're not being honest. Doubts are normal. What did John do with his doubts? He brought them to Jesus, and that's the best place to bring your doubts. Now look at how Jesus answers. In verse 4, Jesus replied, go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind are receiving sight. The lame are walking. Those who have leprosy are being cleansed. The deaf are hearing. The dead are being raised. And the good news is being proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me. What's Jesus actually saying there? He's saying, just look at what I'm doing. Because what I'm doing is called evidence. It speaks for itself. It's demonstrating a very simple fact that I am who I claim to be. I am the Son of God. I'm God come in human flesh. I am the long-awaited Messiah, and I'm doing exactly what you would expect the Son of God to do. And this is where we kind of push pause, because I want to spend the rest of our time focusing on how in the world can you have all these different groups of people looking at the same evidence, the same data, and coming to such very different conclusions. Let's look at some responses, starting in verse 6. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. Then Jesus withdrew from his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd gathered from Galilee. When they heard that all he was doing, many people came from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, the regions across the Jordan, and around Tyre and Sidon. Then you go towards the end of the chapter. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, he is out of his mind. And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, he's possessed by Beelzebub. By the prince of the demons, he is driving out demons. Different people looking at what Jesus is saying, looking at what Jesus is doing, coming to very different conclusions. Let's start by looking at the leaders of Judaism. There's actually a couple different layers to their response. Their immediate response shows how very intense their opposition to Jesus was. I say that because if you go back and you read the text, it says the Pharisees and the Herodians conspired together to kill Jesus. The Pharisees were about as conservative as you could be in that culture. The Herodians, on the other hand, were about as liberal as you could be in that culture. Now, you live in the same world that I do. Can you imagine the conservative Republicans and the progressive Democrats agreeing on anything? Because I can't. If one of them says the sun's going to come up tomorrow, the other one's going to say, no, it isn't. And vice versa. They do not see eye to eye, not even close. And that's what the Herodians and the Pharisees were like. But they did have one thing in common. We need to get rid of Jesus. Jesus is a threat. We need to kill him. And I'm pretty sure anytime your response to someone or something like Jesus is, we need to kill him, that's just plain wrong. These people may be the leaders of Judaism. Remember, we were talking about religious sinners and irreligious sinners? Spot on. They may be very religious. They're still sinners. They're still evil in their heart. How do I know? They want to kill Jesus. They have murder in their hearts. So their first layer of response is, we just need to kill this guy. Totally closed-minded. Their second response is, they have to explain the miracles that Jesus is doing in some way. Because too many people have seen Jesus perform miracles. They're seeing it with their own two eyes. That needs to be explained. You can't just, dismiss that. So their conclusion is, Jesus is doing this because he is being empowered by Satan. And that would explain the miraculous part. But it's still an inadequate answer. Because we've already seen the kind of things that Satan does. when he possesses people, what happens? Their life becomes more wonderful, right? No. Jesus describes Satan as the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Satan is the author of evil. What is Jesus doing? Jesus is doing good. He's setting people free. He's doing things that are the complete opposite of what Satan has done. And so Satan may explain the miraculous, but you'd have to say Satan is schizophrenic. Because on one hand he's doing good, and on one hand he's doing evil, and that just doesn't make any sense. But what this answer does do is it condemns these leaders. Because elsewhere in Scripture, that explanation is called blaspheming the Holy Spirit, which is also called the unpardonable sin. And here's why it's the unpardonable sin. When you consider sin, here's the reality. There's one sin and only one sin that cannot be forgiven. You know what that sin is? It's the sin of unbelief. If you believe in Jesus, I don't care what you've done, and I don't care how often you've done it, you can be forgiven. The Apostle Paul, writing to Timothy, said that he saw himself as the foremost sinner because Paul used to go and arrest Christians, bring them to the Jewish courts, have them convicted, and have them executed. And we don't know how many deaths that Paul was responsible for, but they weighed heavily on his heart, and he said, I am the cheapest of sinners. But the good news is, Christ came into the world to save sinners, to forgive sinners of their sin, to restore them to a right relationship to God. Jesus, as we saw, I think it was last week, is God's remedy for sin. What if you refuse to believe in Jesus? How do you solve the sin problem then? You can't. That's why it's called the unpardonable sin. There's no remedy for sin if you refuse to believe in Jesus, who God provided as the remedy for sin. And in the face of undeniable evidence, Jesus is doing the supernatural. They refuse to believe. Instead, they choose to explain it away as being satanic. And as long as they refuse to believe, they cannot be forgiven. Now let's look at the multitudes. Because crowds are gathering, and we would see that. Surely that's a good thing. People are flocking after Jesus. They obviously must believe in Jesus. I think you have to ask the question, why? Why are they following Jesus? And I would suggest to you that when you look at the record of Scripture, you'd find this simple fact. They're following Jesus because they valued the miraculous things that he was doing. It's the equivalent of the circus has come to town, or the county fair is being held. Let's all go to the fair. Let's all go to the circus. Let's all go see what Jesus is going to do. In these crowds, you have two basic kinds of people. You have people that need to be healed or helped in some way. And you have a bunch of people who want to see what Jesus will do next. But what you don't see, I believe, is saving faith. And here's why I say that. In John chapter 6, Jesus disappoints these crowds. These crowds expected Jesus to conform to their messianic ideals. They expected the Messiah to come, put their arms around the leaders of Judaism and say, thank you guys, you have done a wonderful job watching over Judaism, but I'm going to take it from here. But here, let me give you a nice plaque that you can put on your wall, and now I'm going to take over. And that Jesus would then go over to Rome and squash Caesar and all the armies of Rome, and then he would establish his kingdom, and all of these religious elites would rule and reign in with Jesus, and we'd all live happily ever after. That's what they expected. And Jesus comes along and presents himself as a Savior who's going to go to the cross and die to pay for sin. And a big part of their response is, well, we don't need a Savior because we're not sinners. And when Jesus did not meet their expectations, and when Jesus asked them to accept him for who he was and commit to his plan, here's what happened. From that time, many of his disciples turned back and they no longer followed him. Because the only reason they were following him was because of the immediate benefit they received. And as soon as that in their mind was no longer true, I'm not getting any benefit from following this Jesus guy, they were gone. Now let's look at Jesus' family. Then Jesus entered a house, and a crowd gathered so that he and his disciples weren't even able to eat. But when his family heard about this, what did they do? They came to take charge of him, for they said, he is out of their mind. Now, we don't know who all is a part of his family in this sense. After age 12, where Jesus, Mary, and Joseph go up to the temple for what we would call Jesus's bar mitzvah, we don't hear about Joseph anymore in Scripture. Most people conjecture he may have died. We're told in Scripture that his brothers and sisters did not become believers until after the resurrection. And we're told in Scripture about a lot of things that happened in and around Jesus' birth. As far as Mary is concerned, I think she had probably the clearest idea of who Jesus was. So I don't know that we could say that his family would include Mary, because I have a hard time seeing Mary coming to the conclusion, my son Jesus, who I gave birth to miraculously as a virgin. My son Jesus, who angels came and told me to name him Jesus because he was going to be the Savior. My son Jesus is mad. That doesn't make sense to me. So I don't know that Mary's here. I don't even know if Joseph is alive. But I know his brothers and sisters don't believe. How many of you had a brother or sister? Okay, now, I have one brother. And I'm pretty certain there were times when he thought I was nuts. And I know for a fact there were times when I thought he was nuts. And neither one of us ever claimed to be Jesus. That's just my brother, and he's stupid. He's nuts, he's goofy, and vice versa. That's the way brothers and sisters are, right? They're looking at Jesus not so much as he's this guy. Now, I don't know that they can understand how he did what he did, but I'm thinking that idea of brother and sister probably is winning the day in their mind, and their conclusion is, our brother is nuts. We better go rescue him from himself. And it's not the first time that has happened. Over in John 10, the Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said he's demon-possessed. We've heard that before. And others said he's raving mad. Why listen to him? And it's not just true of Jesus. Later in Paul's life, when he's on trial for the simple fact that he's a Christian, At this point, Festus interrupted Paul's defense. And he said, "You are out of your mind, Paul. Your great learning is driving you insane." It is not uncommon for Christianity to be dismissed as irrational. Let's look at one more response. And it's the response of the 12. Jesus went up on a mountainside, and he called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. And he appointed 12 that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. Here's what's happening here. Jesus knows what his mission is. And a big part of his mission is he's going to go to the cross. He's going to die to pay for the sins of the entire world. He's going to rise from the grave so that he can offer humanity eternal life. He knows that. But that's not the totality of his mission. He also knows there is a day when he is going to return to his Father. And people that he has called to follow him will carry on his work. And so here he's calling the 12, and he's basically calling them to partner with him. He is going to train them. He is then going to pass them the baton to carry on his work when he returns to the Father in heaven. To accept that invitation means you have to respond to Jesus very differently than the way the religious leaders were, than the way the multitudes were, than the way his family was. Here's how you would have to respond if you want to accept this invitation. Jesus said to his followers, "Whoever wants to be my follower, here's what's required. It starts with deny yourself. Take up your cross. Take up your purpose in life, the mission that God has for you. And that will cost you your life." Because that's what the cross did. The cross killed people. And when you take up your cross, it's going to cost you your life. And then you follow me. And Jesus further explains. Now, if you hesitate, and you decide, well, maybe I don't want to deny myself. Maybe I don't want to take up my cross and sacrifice my life for you. Maybe I don't want to be one of your followers. If you try to save your life for yourself, you'll lose it. But if you will relinquish your life to me, if you will lose your life for me, you will find life. Life to its very full. Let me try to wrap this up for the day. Every single reaction we see in Mark chapter 3 are reactions that we see in the world every single day in 2018. Secularism, atheism, rejects Jesus in the same way and with the same degree of hostility as the religious leaders in Jesus' day. The only difference between the two responses is the religious leaders in Jesus' day thought they were being loyal to Jehovah, the God of the Old Testament, and they saw Jesus as a usurper. A modern-day secularist has a completely different God. Their God is humanism and natural processes. They believe in science and evolution, and there is no need for a God. Everything just happens. And they have a hostility toward Christianity or faith in general, but you rarely see an atheist protesting anything other than Christianity. Makes you wonder. Anyway, we see secularism. The prosperity gospel. I don't know if you know what that is, but it's a segment within Christianity. I don't know how genuine I would understand that word Christianity to be in this context. But they are very much like the multitudes. They have a very self-centered faith. In their faith, God exists to serve them and their interests. He's kind of like the genie in the lamp. They just have to rub him the right way so that he will bless them. And the only reason to be involved with God is a means to get ahead. And if there's no means to get ahead, then why bother? As far as Christianity being irrational, that's probably the only one up there other than true belief that makes sense. Because our faith requires us to accept by faith things that are beyond rational comprehension. The idea that God would come in human flesh. The idea that Jesus would die, be buried, and rise again. I can't prove that. I can't comprehend that. I accept it by faith. And many people will look at those same data points and say, that's crazy, that's irrational, you Christians are delusional. But then we have the 12. And they represent true belief. Jesus said, you want to be my follower, you got to deny yourself. We've already seen Peter and Andrew leave fishing to follow Jesus. Last week we saw Matthew leave being a tax collector and follow Jesus. All of the 12 denied themselves. They took up their purpose and they followed Jesus. They represent true belief, and as I've said before, they change the world. We are here because of men like the 12. Now, we started with a premise. There's no middle ground on Jesus. Everyone has to make up their mind. And here's the reality. If you look at the evidence and you come to this conclusion, it's a lie, it's a hoax, it's a fraud, it's whatever. And if you come to the conclusion Jesus is not the Son of God, you can dismiss him without consequences. He is no threat. If he is not who he claims to be, he's some kind of liar or lunatic. The only reason he could ever be a threat is if he is in fact the Son of God, if he is in fact the Savior. Now, what do we know from God, from Mark's gospel? We know Jesus claimed to be God's Son. We know he acted in ways that demonstrate clearly that he had divine power. And we know the authors of Scripture recorded all of these things to preserve the record so that there would be written evidence to support our belief. And if Jesus is in fact God's Son, the idea of dismissing him, that is what's crazy. If Jesus is in fact God's Son, there's only one appropriate response. And that is belief. And every single one of us must weigh the evidence. And every single one of us has to make up our minds and make a decision. Jesus is either who he claims to be, he's who the Bible presents him to be, or he's an imposter. And you're free to choose he's an imposter. But you're going to have an awful lot of, I'll call them mental gymnastics, to stay there. Because if he's an imposter, the 12 knew it because they were right there. And every single one of them guys laid down their life and died for what they knew was absolutely untrue. And this whole thing we call Christianity that's been in existence and has changed the world for thousands of years is built on a fraud. That's really hard to get your arms around. That how could that happen? It may just be that it's all true. And if it's all true, You need to believe. You need to follow. Are you ready to do that? That's the question. Everybody has to make up their mind about Jesus. I did that January 2nd, 1975. And I'm going to invite you to make that decision for yourself today if you never had. Can we pray together? It's quite possible God has been working in your life. I believe God is everywhere all the time. I believe he is always at work. And I believe one of the things that he does is he draws us to belief. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. The Holy Spirit takes the word of God and taps us on the shoulder and says, this is for you. And it's quite possible God has been speaking to you. And if you are ready to believe, if you're ready to follow Jesus in the way that the 12 did, I'm going to invite you to pray a simple prayer with me as we close. Father, I thank you for sending Jesus. I recognize that he is your son, that he came and took human form so that he could be my Savior. I thank you that he took the sins of the entire world on himself and went to the cross and died there to pay for them in full. And I thank you that he rose from the dead. And he offers me eternal life if I will just believe. And Father, I am ready to believe. I have felt you bringing me to this place. I have felt you persuading me and influencing me. I am ready to believe. I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. And I invite you to come into my life and take control. I want you to be my leader. I want you to be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for bringing me here this day where I can make this important decision. I want you in my life. Come into my life and be my Savior. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.